Imagine building a wild Rube Goldberg machine, a contraption so elaborate and convoluted that it makes you wonder how it even works. Levers, pulleys, dominoes, and a bowling ball or two, all working together in a ridiculously complex chain reaction. Every extra path, every unnecessary step, or every branch makes it exponentially harder to predict, test, and ultimately fix when something goes wrong. It becomes a tangled mess of dependencies. That's the essence of cyclomatic complexity, a concept that might sound intimidating but is actually quite straightforward. At its core, it measures how many different routes your code can take, how many different execution paths exist within a given piece of code. It's not about how long your code is or the sheer volume of lines you've written. It's about how tangled the logic gets, how many twists and turns a program has to navigate to reach its destination. 10 lines with lots of ifs and loops nested within each other can be way more complex and therefore more prone to errors than 100 lines of straight sequential code that executes in a predictable manner. Cyclomatic complexity gives you a number, a single metric that quantifies this tangledness. It's a quick gut check for how convoluted your logic is, providing a simple way to assess the potential risk associated with a particular piece of code. Low numbers mean simple, reliable code, code that's easy to understand, test, and maintain. High numbers? You've built a mystery machine no one wants to fix, a potential breeding ground for bugs and unexpected behavior. Why care? Because complexity is the enemy of good engineering and a silent killer of software projects. It breeds bugs, those pesky little gremlins that can wreak havoc on your application. It makes code fragile, prone to breaking with even the smallest change. And it turns quick fixes into multi-day headaches, leaving developers frustrated and projects behind schedule. Measuring cyclomatic complexity lets you spot the risky, over-engineered parts of your code base, the areas that are most likely to cause problems down the line, before they break, allowing you to refactor and simplify before disaster strikes. It's a tool for proactive builders, developers who want to create robust and maintainable software, helping you simplify before you even start coding, by encouraging you to think critically about the logic of your programs. The goal? Build things that are robust, understandable, and fixable, software that can stand the test of time. Because trust me, everything breaks eventually, and when it does, you'll be grateful you kept things simple. So, how do we put a number on code complexity? There's a formula M equals sign EN plus 2. M is the cyclomatic complexity score. E is the number of edges, connections. N is the number of nodes, decision points. Think of it like mapping a town. Intersections are nodes, streets are edges. The more weird intersections and one-way streets, the higher the complexity. Or use the shortcut start at 1, then add 1 for every if, while, for, case, and, or in your code. Each decision point adds a new possible path. A score of 110 is good. 11-20, getting complicated. Over 20, red flag. If you see 50 or more, it's time for serious code surgery. This isn't just a number, it's a warning sign. Use it to keep your code simple and maintainable. Let's dive into a practical demonstration. We're going to see cyclomatic complexity in action, breaking down how it manifests in code. Understanding this metric is crucial for writing maintainable and efficient software. Let's start with something incredibly basic. Take a function that adds two numbers, a fundamental operation. This will serve as our baseline for understanding how complexity increases. In this function, there are no choices, no branching paths, just a straight line from input to output. It's as direct as it gets. Consequently, the cyclomatic complexity is 1. This indicates the simplest possible control flow. Now let's introduce a bit of decision making. Add an if statement to check a condition. For example, if someone's old enough for a driver's license, this introduces a conditional path. Now we have two possible paths. Old enough, which executes one block of code, or not old enough, which executes a different block, or perhaps does nothing. The cyclomatic complexity jumps to 2, reflecting the added decision point. Let's keep going and add another check, nesting an if statement within another, perhaps to determine did they also pass the written test. This adds another layer of conditional logic. Now you've got an and in your condition, requiring both age and test results to be true. Each extra condition or logical operator adds to the complexity, increasing the number of possible execution paths through the code. Suddenly, you're up to 3 paths: old enough and passed the test, old enough but failed the test, or simply too young to even take the test. See how quickly it grows. Even with seemingly simple additions, the number of potential pathways explodes. Now let's consider a more real-world example. Imagine a shipping cost function with if statements to account for the destination country, the package weight, a switch statement to select the shipping speed, and loops to calculate special handling fees or regional taxes. Each decision point piles on more paths, making the code harder to understand, test, and maintain. What looks simple on the surface can quickly balloon to a cyclomatic complexity of 15 or even 20, indicating a high risk of errors and difficulties in debugging. That's your cue to step back and ask yourself, can I refactor this? Can I make this simpler and more readable? Cyclomatic complexity provides a valuable metric that helps you spot when your code is getting out of hand and becoming overly complicated. It's a signal to refactor, to break down the function into smaller, more manageable pieces, before things get too messy and unmanageable. Keep it simple, strive for clarity, and your future self, along with your colleagues, will thank you immensely for the maintainable and understandable code. Let's visualize the formula. We're going to take a look at how we can represent our code in a way that makes its complexity immediately apparent. This isn't just about abstract numbers. It's about creating a visual representation that guides our understanding and helps us make informed decisions about refactoring and optimization. M equals sine E, N plus 2. This formula, while simple, provides a powerful way to quantify the complexity of your code based on its structure. It's a tool that helps us move beyond subjective feelings about code complexity and towards a more objective assessment. Draw your code as a control flow graph, a visual representation of the paths your code can take. This is where the magic happens, where abstract code transforms into a tangible map. Each block of code is a node, representing a distinct action or state. Each possible jump or transition between blocks is an edge, showing the flow of execution. Think of it as a roadmap for your code's journey. For our driver's license example, the one we've been using to illustrate complexity, let's see how this works in practice. We'll break down the code into its fundamental components and map them onto our control flow graph. We begin with an entry node, the starting point of our code's execution. This is where the process begins, the initial state from which all other actions flow. Then, a decision node, representing a conditional statement or branching point. This is where the code makes a choice based on some condition and follows one path or another. From the decision node, we have two outcome nodes representing the different paths the code can take based on the decision. And finally, an exit node, marking the end of the code's execution. Count the number of nodes and edges in your control flow graph. This is the raw data we need to apply our complexity formula. Now plug those numbers into the formula, M equals sine E, N plus 2. This calculation will give you a numerical representation of the code's complexity, and you'll find that you get the same complexity score as the shortcut method we discussed earlier. This confirms the validity of both approaches and provides a deeper understanding of what the complexity score represents. This map, this control flow graph, shows you the real underlying structure of your code, revealing its inherent complexity. It's a powerful tool for understanding and managing your code base. When complexity is low, when the code is well structured and easy to understand, the graph is clean, linear, and easy to follow. It's a visual representation of clarity and maintainability. High complexity, when the code is convoluted and difficult to grasp, the graph looks like spaghetti, a tangled mess of interconnected nodes and edges. Arrows going everywhere, loops feeding into loops, creating a confusing and difficult to navigate structure. If you can't draw a clear map of your code, if the structure is too complex to represent visually, you'll struggle to debug it, to understand it, or to extend the code with new features. Visualizing complexity makes it immediately obvious where things are too tangled, where the code needs attention. It highlights the problematic sections, the areas that are contributing most to the overall complexity. Use the graph to spot potential trouble spots, to identify areas that are likely to cause problems in the future. Do this before it becomes a nightmare, before the complexity spirals out of control and the code becomes unmanageable. If your code's map is a mess, if the control flow graph is a tangled web, it's time to simplify, to refactor, to break down the complex code into smaller, more manageable pieces. A clean map, a clear control flow graph, means easier maintenance, reduced debugging time, and improved overall code quality. And ultimately, fewer bugs, leading to a more reliable and robust system. Draw it out, create that visual representation of your code structure, and let the picture, the control flow graph, guide your refactoring efforts, helping you to create cleaner, more maintainable code. Why count complexity? Because it's your early warning system. When the score creeps up, it's a sign to refactor before bugs and technical debt pile up. Low complexity means easier maintenance. Future you and your teammates will thank you. High complexity is a risk magnet. More paths mean more places for bugs to hide. Testing two paths is easy. Testing 50? You'll miss something. Keeping complexity low is smart risk management. It also makes you a better designer. High complexity usually means a function is doing too much. Measuring complexity nudges you to break big problems into smaller, focused functions. Your code becomes modular, like building blocks, not a giant, fragile sculpture. The result? Robust, flexible, and maintainable software. Cyclomatic complexity isn't just a number. It's a tool for building better code. Use it to spot trouble, simplify, and design smarter. That's how you keep your code base healthy. Software isn't a one-and-done sculpture, it's a car that needs constant maintenance. Most costs come from keeping it running, not building it. Complexity is the main driver of maintenance headaches. High cyclomatic complexity means high cognitive load fixing bugs becomes a mental marathon. Refactoring is your best tool to run a complexity analysis. Find the worst offenders and break them into smaller, simpler functions. Focus on the hotspots for the biggest impact. Reducing a monster function's complexity from 50 to 5 is a huge win. The logic becomes clear, bugs are easier to find and changes are safer. You're not just cleaning up code, you're making life easier for everyone who touches it. Tame the beast, and you bring order to chaos. That's real engineering. For testers, cyclomatic complexity is gold. The number tells you the minimum test cases needed for full path coverage. If a function's complexity is 5, you need at least 5 tests to cover every path. No more guessing. Test planning becomes systematic. Use the control flow graph to design tests for each unique path. For complex legacy code, the complexity score helps estimate testing effort and cost. It also shows where testing resources are most needed. Focus on the riskiest, most complex parts first. Cyclomatic complexity makes your testing smarter, not harder. That's how you build quality into your code. I once inherited a massive, fragile code base, the beast. Every change risked breaking something else. Morale was low, progress slow. We needed a plan, not chaos. Running a static analysis, we found most code was fine, but some functions had sky-high complexity. One monster function had a complexity of 128, thousands of lines, all business logic jammed together. We targeted that dragon, extracting small, testable pieces one at a time. Each extraction lowered the monster's complexity and grew our test suite. After months, we'd split it into 30 small, understandable functions, each with low complexity. The beast was tamed. Bugs dropped, changes got easier, and the team breathed easier. Cyclomatic complexity gave us the map to slay the dragon. You don't have to fix everything at once, just start with the worst. That's how you turn legacy nightmares into success stories. One number made all the difference. Cyclomatic complexity isn't a magic bullet, but it's a powerful tool. It gives you objective data, not just gut feelings, about your code's health. It encourages good habits, smaller focused functions and clear logic. Clarity always beats cleverness. Write code anyone can understand even a year from now. Managing complexity is the heart of engineering, no matter what you build. Use cyclomatic complexity as a guide, not a law. Let it spark conversations and highlight hotspots. By paying attention to this one number, you'll build more robust, maintainable software. If you are in doubt, then talk with the NUCIDA QA experts. That's a myth confirmed. Now go build something awesome and keep it simple. Happy testing and see you next time.